There are fresh fears for struggling businesses in Sydney and Melbourne's CBD in the last couple of days because of a lack of assistance out of yesterday's announcement in relation to travel stimulus for the city hotels. Of course, they've been hit hard, but they didn't figure much in the Prime Minister's announcement yesterday. One industry representative, Accommodation Association Chief Executive Dean Long, says the government has completely abandoned our CBD hotels. Dean Long joins me now from Sydney. Dean, thanks for your time tonight. I'm focused very much on the issue of our CBDs. I haven't been yet to Sydney. I'm going to Sydney next week, but I've certainly been in and around Melbourne in recent months, and it's in a terrible state. Now, you'd expect that. It was hit very hard by the lockdowns. But you say you're disappointed in the Prime Minister's announcement yesterday. There's not much on the table for city hotels. Help us understand how COVID's impacted them.
What we've seen across the city hotels, particularly in Sydney and Melbourne, is they're reliant on two markets, one being the corporate domestic traveller and the second being the international traveller. Now, to put this in perspective, I'll give you some statistics about why we were disappointed in yesterday's announcement. If we look at Far North Queensland, for example, 34% of their visitors come from an international source market. Now, we're not asking for Far North Queensland to be excluded, but we're asking for our capital cities, because 70% of the visitors to Sydney and Melbourne come from the international tourism space. And that's the part this package is meant to stimulate, and that's what's been missed.
So why do you think that the CBD hotels were left out?
Well, we're not really sure. We're waiting for the government to come back to us on that. I think it's a little bit of pre-COVID thinking by the machinery of government. I think what we've seen through this pandemic is the first move by government is to go back to what they've always known, which is stimulate the regions because they need the support. At no point in the last 100 years have our major capital cities, such as Sydney and Melbourne, our international gateways, needed support. But if I give you, if we go through to May, and I've managed to get these stats from the leading hotel groups today, if we go to May, they're currently sitting on a 91% vacancy rate. That's only a 9% occupancy. And that's because the international borders are closed, and there's no confidence the premiers won't close the border if there's only one case of corona.
I guess the other issue too, it isn't just people staying in the rooms, it's all the functions and the weddings and the events, the corporate events as well, the breakfasts and all the things that go on in these big, you know, hotel dining rooms and function centres. They're also been hit hard. What happens at the end of this month without JobKeeper?
Unfortunately, we are going to see some additional job losses in our Sydney and Melbourne hotels. And these aren't people who are casual workers that see the hospitality and accommodation industry as a gap year. These are highly skilled hospitality workers. These are the best chefs, cooks, waiters, revenue managers in the industry and in the world. It's why we export more accommodation professionals to the rest of the world than really any other professional services. And unfortunately now, we're going to have to let them go because there's not enough in this for our capital cities and our professionals in the Australian accommodation sector.
I know a lot of the restaurateurs in Melbourne that I speak to desperately need the workers to come back, but they also want the holidaymakers to come back to the cities. And, of course, that's hard because there's not the events, as I said, and there's not the weddings and all the other things that we usually would go to a capital city for. But clearly they're interdependent. What do you want the federal government to do? If they were listening to the criticism, and they've had plenty of it in the last 24 hours, mm-hmm. If they were listening to the criticism, what do they need to do to fix this? And not just federal government, I have to say, state governments as well. What do you want to see have happen?
I think what we need to see from state governments straight away is that when they announce voucher programs and they design them, they include accommodation in there. We know the two drivers of domestic travel, it's airfares and it is a place to stay. If I look at the Labor government's announcement for Far North Queensland only this week for their voucher program, specifically excluded accommodation on Far North Queensland. So state governments need to include those voucher programs. They need to roll them out. I do have to give credit to the Victorian government. They made the adjustment quickly there. And today, in 4 minutes, there were 65,000 people apply for vouchers to stay in Melbourne. And that's exactly what we need to see. We need the New South Wales government to do that particularly. But the federal government has a responsibility here. They've spoken about a sovereign risk if we lost our airline specialists and providing a dedicated package for those employees. The Australian government has to back our hospitality workers, our highly skilled workers, by announcing exactly the same package to keep our guys employed and working. So when they get off the plane in Sydney, Melbourne, Brisbane, Adelaide, Perth, we deliver the world-class service we're renowned for.
All right, Dean Long, thank you for your time.
Great to be with you.